As you know from your program, I have the luckiest job all day long. I get to sit here with the cast of The Wire and some other folks who were involved in inspiring that program. And I just have to say it's a thrill for me as somebody who was turned onto it by my 24-year-old son, who is somewhere out here in the crowd, Ben. And as somebody who doesn't find a lot to watch that we think is really worth watching in the way of entertainment television these days, The Wire was something we were absolutely glued to and were distraught when it went off the air 3 years ago. Having said that, The Wire goes on and it continues to inspire and continues to be a subject of conversation. And as you'll be hearing over the next 45 minutes or so from this incredible panel, the folks involved with The Wire are taking it to another level. They want to continue what started with that program and use it as a way to get people in the country thinking more about what goes on in the center of our cities. So let me just first introduce this amazing group. I'm going to start on my left, on your right, with Donnie Andrews. Donnie is the real-life inspiration for the character Omar in The Wire. He saw his, I'm going to put it to you raw, he saw his first dead body lynched and hanging from a tree in North Carolina when he was just 4 years old. So Donnie had a rough upbringing, a rough childhood. From there he moved to Baltimore and got involved in armed robberies, and you can read more about his biography with the materials you were given. He ended up spending 17 years in prison for murder, but today he is the head of a nonprofit organization in the city of Baltimore, Why Murder, counseling young gang members and trying to be an inspiration through his own life story. So we're going to be hearing from Donnie in just a moment. Next to Donnie and next to me is Sonia Sohn. I'm sure you recognize her as Kima Griggs from The Wire. Sonia. This is so much more fun for me than doing a panel on the debt ceiling. Which is what I'm used to talking about. Kima, just so you know, I want to call you Kima, Sonia.
It's okay, go ahead. I answer to it all the time.
Sonia is now in ABC's Body of Proof. She first came to wide industry attention in Slam, which is a Sundance Grand Jury Prize winner, which she starred in and co-wrote. She was raised in Newport News, Virginia. She worked on films like Martin Scorsese's Bringing Out the Dead and John Singleton's Shaft before taking on the role of Kima Griggs. Today, Sonia is the founder and CEO of Rewired for Change, and you're going to be hearing about that, a nonprofit working to empower at-risk group youth in underserved communities, and you're going to be hearing much more about that in just a moment. Moving along, next to me, Michael K. Williams, who, again, you recognize him as Omar Little from... Currently, though, you need to know what he's doing now because you want to watch that, too. He is portraying the role of Chalky White on HBO's Boardwalk Empire, so you can find him there. He was born in Brooklyn, New York, and after a rocky few years, I think it's fair to say, in his early 20s, started a career as a dancer and from there found his way into acting. And we're going to hear much more from Michael in just a minute. Seated next to him is Benga Akinabe. Benga, you will recognize for his role as Chris Partlow on The Wire. Benga was actually born right here in Washington. He was raised in Montgomery County, went to school in Montgomery County, went on to college, and after a stint at the Corporation for National Service, he turned to acting. In 2007, he appeared in the film The Savages with Philip Seymour Hoffman and Laura Linney. He appeared in the remake of The Taking of Pelham 123. That was in 2009. And then currently, you need to know, he is starring as Kelly Slater, a nurse in the third season of Nurse Jackie on Showtime. So you can see him there right now. And finally, I want to introduce our fifth panelist, and he is Anwan Big G Glover, who you also could see in The Wire playing the role of Slim Charles. So welcome, Anwan. Born and raised in Washington, is it Adams Morgan? Is that right?
Columbia Heights.
Columbia Heights, Adams. Close to Adams Morgan. At a very young age, he participated in theatrical projects. He went on and got into acting actually pretty early. He went on to create one of the most successful and widely known go-go bands here in the nation's capital, Backyard Band, also known as BYB. And took that on to expand his career in acting. He's also appeared in featured films like The Notorious and Rocket Science, and he's been seen on Law and Order and Ugly Betty. So we have a fantastic group of individuals. I want to get to this right away with a couple of points and then start asking you all questions. I think everybody here, you know, if you read the newspaper, you know that there are new statistics out there all the time telling us about the income and wealth divide in this country, the widest it's ever been. Well-offs doing much better than everybody else who are just marginally getting along. The Census Bureau told us just recently that an unbelievable 47 million Americans were living in poverty last year. And that's a number we're now told is likely to go up because the Census Bureau is going to update how it calculates the real cost of living in this country. In America's inner cities, the picture is as stark as it can possibly be. Black unemployment is twice that of whites. For black youths, a jaw-dropping 46% in this country are unemployed. Not only that, at the last count, two-thirds of African-American children lived in single-parent households, compared to a quarter of white children. So we're talking about a situation in this country that doesn't get enough attention, and that's why it's so important that we've gathered these folks together. Donnie, I want to start with you because you have an incredible experience living in Baltimore, as we said, growing up in different parts of the country, but spending a number of years in Baltimore. When you hear those statistics and you think back to what you saw growing up, give us just a flavor, a sense of what life was like for you growing up in a city like Baltimore and how you see it change.
Well, growing up in the city, I'm from like West Baltimore, around Poplar Grove, Evanston, and Bryce, and during back in the day, you know, we had the street cars, and Evanston Avenue was like a black mecca, like Pennsylvania Avenue, and we had the stores and everything. And then after the 68 riots, you know, the stores got burned down, and they never got rebuilt. And ever since the riots, I believe, you know, our community been going down ever since because they put money in the harbor, but they don't put it in the city. You know, they will go and, if they need a statue in the harbor, and we got a big 6-foot pothole in Emerson Village somewhere, the harbor going to get the statue, and we might get a plate if we lucky. You know, so it's real difficult because, you know, not only have the structural foundation changed, but the people changed, you know, and of course back then you could leave your door open, you know, people would look out for you, you know, like now, like we going through this struggle now, you know, people will come up, you know, G family needs something to eat, my mother will fix them food, and, you know, right. They don't do that. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like nobody trusts anybody, it's like, you know,
there was a community.
It was a community, you know. Mm-hmm. And right now, it's like, it's, you know, even with the drug game, everything changed. Everything has changed.
You were quoted, I saw where you said, and this is actually a brochure for Why Murder. You said, growing up in West Baltimore's housing projects, you recall the word future wasn't even in your vocabulary because you didn't know if you were going to be alive or dead the next day.
We all live for the moment. You know, you see, when you're out on the street, you have to do what your community is doing. If your community is representing violence, then you got to be the most violent person on the block, or you gonna get run over. You know, it's like me. I was fortunate. I was able to see this side. You know, I was able to see different sides. You know, but they don't. I had a kid that I took to New York back in the 70s, and he went there like a country boy, looking at the big buildings like, wow, because he'd never been out of the project. You know, so it's very difficult. Only thing that don't change in Baltimore is the corner. The people change, the corner stays the same.
Michael Williams, what about, you didn't grow up in Baltimore, it was Brooklyn, but when you hear the kind of statistics, you know, people throw around, how do you connect that to what you saw growing up and what you think? I mean, what troubles you and why you're here today?
You know, when I look at the numbers and the statistics that you talked about earlier, the first thing that comes to my mind is gratitude, because I was supposed to be one of those numbers. I, you know, everything that I was exposed to coming up in East Flatbush, Brooklyn, growing up in the projects, I should have been dead several times over, you know, and the same, you know, different toilet, same toilet paper, you know what I mean? We have okay, Baltimore, Brooklyn, you know, but the rules were the same. You either eat or you get eaten. And my issue was, the difference between Donnie and I growing up, but I didn't have that gene to come out fighting. So, you know, I was easy prey. I was not the, you know, although I aspired to be what the guys growing up in my neighborhood were, I didn't have that gene. And it cost me a lot. It cost me a lot of pain and a lot of anguish. And I grew up trying to fit in. You know, I guess we all did. You know, my thing was I took to drugs and alcohol very early as a way to compensate, numb the pain of not feeling accepted by my peers and my community, you know. And I look around now today as a man, and I thank God, I'm so grateful that maybe I didn't fit in, you know, because a lot of my friends who I aspire to want to be like, they either dead or in jail. You know, my circle of friends that I have around me today, who I call my friends, none of them know me pre-wire. I don't have one close friend in my circle that I can say, remember when he was growing up and someone was 10 years old and there's no one there. I don't have friends from high school, dead or in jail or moved out the state. But, you know, every once in a while I'll get a hit on Facebook, but it's that connection of, you know, where you hear stories of people being friends from high school and things of that nature. I don't have those relationships.
So it's that community that you all are saying again just isn't there, or wasn't there.
It
still isn't.
It was there for a minute. You know, growing up, I do remember, you know, my mother raised me as, you know, I wasn't allowed to fight. She was raising boys in the projects by herself, and she was real adamant about not having us learn to deal with differences with our hands. So if you picked on me as a child, even though you started, if I fought you, I got chastised because she would rather me come upstairs, talk to her, and then have her go talk to the parents. Now, if the parent was ignorant, I seen her knock a few women out. I wasn't allowed to fight, but there was that village. Like she gave, there were a group of women that I was allowed to play within three buildings. Like, you know, my projects, we had these chunks of buildings that were all connected, and I was 3301, 3303, and 3305, and all the women, they had carte blanche to knock any one of us upside the head if they saw one of us doing wrong. That's gone now. You know, you're scared to talk to a child, you know, it's like Donnie said, everything has changed. And I think, from just my point of view, you know, when crack hit the streets, from what I can remember, we things really, really changed. And, you know, we're like three generations in on crack babies, you know. So the village, the villages has suffered for that.
And Juan, how does that sound anything like what you were facing when you were growing up?
Kind of exactly. Growing up in Columbia Heights, you guys can see now with the regentrification and the whole change, with the Best Buys and the whole buildings and everything changed. My little sector, our little squad, our buildings are the same. We're right there in the middle. So with just the fixing up around us and not going into our community, with like the different programs, the arts, these kids are structured for failure. So as I came up in my household, with now I'm my mom's only child living, all of my siblings are gone. So you got this young kid that's right here. When he comes out of his building to go to school, like my first, it was fifth grade, was coming out of my building, and it was a dead body by the trash can. And when I came from school, that dead body was still there. They just had the tape out there. So when a kid sees that and he tries to get out, and there's no outlets and no programs for acting, for dance, and the things that I did in my household with my older brother, you had to be tough. I didn't want to be tough. I just wanted to be a kid. Mm-hmm. I wanted to play the horn. I wanted to dance, but you was quote unquote soft if you wanted to be in the male ensemble, you wanted to dance. I could box, I did all the sports, but you had to go by certain rules. So the way it is now, like Donnie said, like you just can get a sandwich from this house, the older lady, Miss Ken, she'll put everything together. You know, kids can get a sandwich if your mom's not home after school. The older people now in the community, they're scared to even ask a younger guy, can you help me across the street, because they don't know if they're gonna get robbed. And there's no programs for the kids to be like, okay, this is what we're gonna do. I've been through this, I know what's going on, I'm gonna structure you the right way. I'm gonna take you this way, I'm gonna hold your hand. Everything has changed and it's building up, but who is it being built for? You know, we go through everyday struggle and pain, and we go through the walks of life. I always tell my kids, it's always a rear view window. That's your past. When you're looking through that rear view, leave it in the past. You always have to go forward. So it's just it's so many things that we really need to embed in our young brothers and sisters today. And it's so touching just to be able to come into school and talk to the kids and they be like, okay, because they told me I wasn't gonna amount to nothing. But look at me. This is what I always tell you.
Who told you that?
This is the story. The teachers, everybody. You know, because I used to act out. I had to act out because my brother, my older brother, he's dead now. He's passed on. He used to tell us that we had to be this certain way. But I used to act different, and then like I used to just like spaz out, have these tantrums and spaz out, but I was a talented young kid. Started my own band, I did a whole lot. But when you're being taught this way, this is all you know. The violence, the being into it, and I just see in my community is being built up, but you still have that middle where the kids are still out on the corner and we out all night.
And that hasn't changed?
Not at all.
Sonia, you grew up, as I said, in Newport News, Virginia. What did you see growing up that sort of has affected you and made you do what you're doing today?
I had very much the same type of experiences as the fellows did, but from a more female perspective, I suppose.
Well, we want to hear the female.
You know, I grew up in an underserved community. I think a difference for me was that I grew up mixed race in an all black community, and I think I know that my brother went through the same things that these guys went through, which was it sounds like very much like a it sounds very much like a jungle environment. You know, it's kill or be killed. You know, I think it's very different when you grow up in a community that's in survival mode and a community that's in growth mode. I think more middle class and upper class communities are about growth. How are we supporting our children? How are we nurturing them? You know, and that's how you, you know, how one, I believe, should, you know, treat children. But, you know, in our communities, there was a lot of proving, you know, your place. You know, I was one of the girls. I mean, you know, we're all, you know, African Americans, so we have a specific set of issues, you know, to our culture, particularly African Americans in growing up in underserved communities. So I was a girl who had the good hair, and my mother was Korean, and, you know, the first person that's going to be picked on or going to be tested, the first chick that's going to be tested is going to be, you know, that one. And you know, I had to, you know, you know, walk, you know, a fine line of, you know, being really tough and being able to talk crap and fight the good fight. I mean, you know, one time, and my mama knew it too. You know, she had a little Asian warrior in her. You know, one day she just she got sick of me coming in the house and crying about this boy picking on me. And she said, you know, I'm sick of this damn shit. She goes into the broom closet and she takes out a broom handle with no broom on. She stuck it in my hand and she pushed me out the door. And I was like, shit. And all the boys are sitting on top of the slide. And I'm like, well, I got permission. And I just walked straight up that slide. I mean, but you know, it's funny. I mean, I cracked him side his head. He fell down the sliding board. Whoa. I was the hero of the day. And I didn't get messed with for about a year. I mean, you know, and you know what? His sister saw all of this happening, and she was like, listen, you know what? You know, but this is the kind of environment that we grew up in. And I'm not saying that it was, you know, that it was okay. But, you know, this is survival mode. You know, and I personally, I believe that a lot of, you know, these behaviors and a lot of these behaviors have been cultivated over centuries. You know, our ancestors all came across the Middle Passage. Our ancestors were all slaves. Our ancestors all went through tremendous trauma. And when you have ancestors that have gone through tremendous trauma, the way that they then have to, how that manipulates their mind and how they raise their children and the mentality that they end up passing on through the generations, I mean, that's something that's unavoidable. I mean, and the thing is I believe that if we don't really get down to the root cause, I mean, this is complex. This is seriously complex. Then, you know, if we don't start exploring every branch of this tree, we're not going to completely heal. And I think, you know, I will just close with the fact that, you know, this this particular, you know, TEDx Mid-Atlantic forum is about a sense of place. And I think the one thing that we are all stressing is that what did hold our communities together, regardless of the dysfunction, was that there was a community, that there was a village, a sense of a village. You know, we had dysfunction in my block. I could tell you there were like 7 alcoholics in the block, in our block. I can tell you there were at least 4 women that were being domestically abused. But I will tell you that, you know, Baybra across the street and Miss Alice was physically challenged. She had a limp. She had a bad eye. Baybra drank every day. But you know what? They ran the Boy Scout troop, the Cub Scout troop, the Girl Scout troop, and in the summertime, they had a U-Haul trailer in the middle of the parking lot where they had bicycles. She ran a candy store, and if you couldn't afford to have a bike, then she would lend you the bike. She would, for a dime, she would patch up, you know, she would teach you how to patch up your tires. You know, no one has a perfect family, regardless, you know, of where you come from. But, you know, if we come together as a community, you know, we can heal together as a community. And that really is, you know, and that right there, that sense of community, that sense of place, that sense of a family, a universal family, that's really what inspired me to start the Village House, which is one of our initiatives at Rewire for Change, which, you know, some of these guys are founding members of.
And we want to talk about that. And one more personal story I want to hear, though, is Benga Akinabe, who grew up in the Washington area right around here in Montgomery County. You ended up going on to college. You know, your life took a different turn. But hearing all this, how do you connect it to what you saw when you were little?
It's honestly a combination of all these things. My family was homeless here in the United States. We lived in shelters here in Silver Spring. And then we moved into projects in Silver Spring that were not too unlike where G grew up. We were in projects surrounded by suburbs, so it was a very interesting dichotomy that we actually had a fence around us, and the kids on the other side were told, you know, not to play with us, but kids are kids, they're always going to try to play with one another. It's a different structure. You get taught differently, and even if it's not when you're not being taught, you're being taught. You know, families falling apart or not existing, and you've never known that. It's funny, I look at people with parents and or fathers and mothers, and I've never missed that, not having a father, because I've never known it. And so that statistic that you quoted about 1/4 of white families have a single parent household,
right.
I didn't realize that the disparity was so great. And after that, I was in and out of schools, in and out of institutions. I went to, I was in special ed from second grade and then, you know, digressed and went to a school. I'm mentioning names because a lot of you are from the area, so you know, I don't know if some of you know Mark Twain, which no longer exists as of a couple years ago, but it was a school for troubled youths. They sent everyone from the county there. This was your last resort. They classified it seriously emotionally disturbed, and this is where they sent you before you were no longer allowed in public schools. This was my school. I earned my way out, got kicked back in, earned my way out, got kicked back in, and eventually when I was 14, they just sent me to a mental hospital where I was heavily medicated for a while. Which is also why I don't even touch Tylenol now. I hate drugs. It's amazing. And this is how they deal with this is how a lot of problem people are just are dealt with, just drugged and put away. You know, your families aren't addressed, lack of community aren't addressed, because this takes too much time and money. But you're just patching problems. You're, you know, getting rid of problems as opposed to actually dealing with them from the ground up. I was fortunate because when my junior year, I had earned a couple periods into a regular school. So I was in Mark Twain for a couple periods and in a regular school, Magruder, for a couple periods. And finally, I was able to be there, and I wanted to do an after-school activity. I didn't play sports. We didn't have those things. We didn't have the $25 to go play basketball at the in some league growing up. Even in the projects, kids did that. We weren't able to do that. I went out for an after-school activity, and it was wrestling season. And I joined the wrestling team. And then I was recruited Division I the next year. And that is what enabled me to go to college and totally changed the vector of my life. I was fortunate, you know, that I did well and that it just so happened to be a sport going on during that season. I mean, I didn't know anything about it. I just went out for it. But I found something I was passionate about and then became valuable to me. And honestly, it was the first time in my life that I walked into a room and people smiled. I am not exaggerating.
Wow.
It was positive reinforcement that I didn't even know was missing. I just thought things were bad, and that's how it is. You know, and so I learned that how important that is, particularly for children, you know, but adults in general. I heard something about how unhappy children or I think it was unhappy children become broken adults, and how we can start to fix that in when they're young, you know, getting more involved. I mean, that's the reason why we all do what we do now. I mean, we could all just be actors and go on and do these things, but I think because of our backgrounds and because of the show we were involved in, we realized that it doesn't stop at the end of a red carpet or the end of the shooting day. I mean, this is still very much our lives. We carry these ghostly shadows with us, you know.
That's very very powerful from all of you. And I'd love to ask you many, many more questions. But we're also here to talk, as Sonia said, about, you know, what do we do about it? You know, how do we, it's complicated, it's hard, it's complex. Donnie Andrews, you started something called Why Murder? Tell us, you know, why you want, what you're trying to do with that, and how you think it can make a difference.
Why Murder is a program that we're trying to put together with, though. We start out by trying to eliminate the street justice, you know, because...
street justice.
Yeah, the street justice. That's what's killing our neighborhoods and our kids. You know, you got to be the meanest and toughest guy on the block. So if I walk up behind G and put a bullet in his head, you know, then I'm all of a sudden the man to be feared. You know, so we have to stop this mentality.
How do you stop it?
The key is with me. I found out that on my last bid, I did, you know, 18 years actually on feds for murder, and with that murder, this guy asked me, you know, as I stood over him, he asked me why, you know, and that was the turning point in my life. It was like, you know, I'm standing there dumbfounded, like, you know, why am I doing this? You know, this brother looked just like me. He could be my brother, my nephew, cousin. He could be family, you know. And I just did this to him and don't even know why. You know, so this is what's happening in our community. You know, Sonia was telling me earlier where the people came out here and they were speaking about how people get caught up in stuff and they react without thinking, you know. And matter of fact, we had an incident that just happened the other day where, as though we lost a very close friend of mine, our son, you know, and in Baltimore right now we have 168 murders, you know, and that's low. That's a low number. But in Boston, they got 54. Yeah. You know, so we want to bring the number. We're not looking to eliminate it, you know, because, you know, we don't deal with, you know, like the drugs. You know, my wife, Fran Board, she deals with all the drug addicts because, you know, she's from the corner. So, but I try to deal with the sense here, because I noticed that, you know, everything that I did in my lifetime, it wasn't because I wanted to do it. It was more or less I had to do it to establish myself, you know. And
so how young can you start to try to get that message across when the kids are how?
Well, what we did with our kids, we broke the cycle, you know, because we had a cycle, you know, with friends, family, with drugs and my family. And we finally broke the cycle with our kids, you know, because right now we raise my wife's sister kids, you know, so it can be done, and it can be done with one simple ingredient: love and care, you know, because the more people show me that they love me or respect me, the more that I want to do to impress them, you know. And that's the whole key, is to be able to give that one simple touch. People ask me every day, well, what can we do? Go out and just say hello to somebody. Just smile at somebody. Just say, yo, you know, I got a good vibe with you today. I think you're going to be somebody. Mm. You know, just little simple things that can build people morale.
It's a positive reinforcement.
Yes, it is. Yeah.
I want to give everybody, Michael, this reminds me of this community point that Sonia brought up, this notion that there were moms who were looking out after you and your friends when you were growing up. And by the way, I want to say that, you know, when we throw out these statistics about single parent households, the fact is so many of those moms are incredible heroes, and they do an amazing job. I think we need to always make that point every time we throw out this number about, well, so many kids have to grow up in single-parent households, and true, that's harder than a two-parent household, but it is not. We're not casting an aspersion on somebody because they raise their children on their own. In fact, it takes a heroic effort to do that. But Michael, the question I have for you is, what do you think can be done? I mean, you hear what Donnie's working on. How do you connect with these kids when the influences in their lives are overwhelmingly negative?
Well, you know, what struck me as something I can do is like a mentorship. You know, I like Donnie said, these kids need TLC, man. It's some tender, loving care. You know, I've decided to start my organization. It's in the process now of getting fully on its feet. It's called MKW, which stands for Making Kids Win. And we're gonna build community centers. And right. You know, when I look back in my turbulent time in my life, especially growing up, I remember what was the things that kept my attention. You know, because like Banger, you know, just I was just younger. I was prescribed lithium. I was in the first grade, and I was prescribed lithium. I know about, you know, and I was coming over here this morning. I was talking to someone, and he was like, you know, Mike, you don't need to be a rocket scientist to figure this out. You take away sports, you take away the arts, you stick them in hot classrooms with underpaid teachers. You know, a neighborhood that's a high crime neighborhood. You know, it's not brain surgery. You're going to get a disaster. You know, so what struck me as something that I can do is to build these community centers. And granted, they might be based in sports and entertainment, because the arts have truly saved my life. Right. You know. But in this community center, we're going to have a lot of other facets. You know, it's going to be a garden and a greenhouse. We're going to grow, because I've noticed, you know, like Donna, you said, you're at 168 murders in the city of Baltimore. Although I'm from Brooklyn, I go to church in Irvington, New Jersey, and my pastor at Christian Love Baptist Church, my one pastor just in our one church up to this day, he's buried 186 people, all under the age of 30, all murder.
Oh my gosh.
This is not even in this is just a little area, you know, because you have Essex County, you know, then you have this Irvington, from Newark, the surrounding of Newark and Irvington and Union and Oranges. This is just one church, and we've put down 186 people, and the year is not over yet.
It's a war zone.
It's a war zone.
Mm-hmm. Like a war.
So what I want to, you know, this community center, I'm not going to ostracize anybody. If you're in a gang, whatever your deal is outside of these walls, I want everybody to come and feel safe and to be able to and to lock into something positive. My three rules are no violence, no drugs, and no video games. You know, but
thank God.
You know, we're gonna teach other types of sports. I'm gonna have the basketball there because that's a language of the community, but we're gonna also have tennis courts. You know, there's gonna be a counseling from sexual abuse to drug abuse to domestic violence, as much as we can, you know, and, you know, I'm soliciting students from Rutgers, you know, from Johns Hopkins, from Harvard, that will come in and mentorship, you know.
Where's the first one going to be built?
The first one's going to be built in New Jersey. I see, from what I see going on with the gang violence and with the death toll, you know, and the second one will be in East Baltimore. The third one will be in East Flatbush, Brooklyn, you know. So, you know, we're going to have these different council sessions as much as we can. There's going to be doing gun buybacks. We're doing, I call it gang beef squashing. You know, I have the access, because people look at my characters on TV, you know, and they think that I'm that, but I'm here to tell you, my mother was a thug in my house. You know? Anybody that grew up with Mike knew I was soft as baby Pampers. You know? And, you know, it's okay. It took a long time to be comfortable in my own skin. I'm okay with that.
We all wish we knew your mom.
But I know fine brothers like Donnie and Professor Tompkins at Johns University, who got his degree in prison, went from Southside Chicago, he got his degree in prison, and now he's one of the top professors at John Jay in New York City. We have Ja Wee. If anybody's ever seen Brick City, the documentary on the violence in Jersey, mm-hmm. This is one of the leading, he led this, because East Coast gang, you know, are not really respected by the founders, which are in the West Coast, in Los Angeles. There are a few gang sets that are respected and notarized, and Ja Wee ran one of them, you know, and he's turned his life over. We actually met in my church, and so I bring brothers in like that, and if I can get these, I want to get these young brothers to in a place where they can feel safe, you know, minus the law, just you know, hands-on, have people who know how to speak the language and mediate these beefs. But the deal is, they got to come to us before the crime is committed. If you shed the blood, I can't help you now. You know, so we come in there. I mean, I'm willing to do anything. Put the gloves on. If we agree to disagree, you stay on the west side, he stay on the east side, south side, north side. Let's stop the blood, the shedding of the blood in the street. And you know, I believe also too with the garden. I think you know, nutrition is a huge problem. You know, you take away all extracurricular activities. You know, the school system is crap. You know, you stick them in these hot classrooms. You know, you medicate them. You know, Bill Maher, who saw Bill Maher, the new episode of Bill Maher Friday, he made in his 10 new rules, he had a thing about, you know, he said, give your kids drugs for Halloween. I said, pack, do it yourself. Give your, you know, don't wait for them to go outside and get a tampered piece of fruit. Do it yourself. Drug your kids. You know, the stuff they're getting on the street is better than the prescribed drugs they gave us, you know? And he made this reference, and I just feel like that nutrition, you know, if you feed these kids properly and you massage their creative senses, you know, that's all I know is how to, you know, I create, like I said, the art saved me. So massage the creative senses, man, and pray to God that, you know, you touch one.
Wow, that's an extraordinary thing. Yeah. Sonia's doing something very interesting, and before I turn to her, though, I know that Anwan, you're also working putting together an organization that's around the arts.
Right, it's called Dreams Work, because also
it's called
like
Dreams Work.
Dreams Work, like Mike said, the arts saved me too. So we got the kids from Ballou High School, and we shot a bullying film that I wrote called Strange Dream, and it doesn't just touch on the kids that's getting bullied; it touches on the kids that's doing the bullying.
Right.
Because you never know what's going on in that household, what they go through. Mm-hmm. So we try to touch both sides, bullying, be you, be who you are. So we try to talk to the parents. We got the parents involved in it. And it's a good short film. And we shot it, you know. It was great because the kids were involved in it. And if they can see us on TV, they can do it themselves. If they can go out like and capture that moment and be like, okay, where it's just not watching their favorite person on television or on a basketball court. I can do this too. So a lot of times the kids don't have that put to them. Like, okay, come on, let's go do this. Let's do that. The only thing they know is what you tell them. So to have them kids do that and shoot that film, and also the kids shot it. They act in it, they shot it, they direct it, they did the whole thing, the craft services, they did everything. So they was excited. I did that, Mom, look, this is what I did. And they were so excited. And this is what we did with Dreams Work. Now we're writing a few more shorts. And they're so excited. They in production, they like, look, we didn't just put the script together. We was like, okay, what do you think should be changed here? Do you want to shoot this? Do you think this is good? Will you be in this character? Do you think this character fits you? We don't want to put it on the table. We want them to do it. So I think if we have more of that, it'll be better. You just can't put a kid there. I think if you just tell a kid, okay, you gonna do this, ask the kid what you want to do. Like, do you think this would be cool if we do this today? How about you tell us what you want to do today? And I think it'll be way much better.
I think these programs are needed, and they are wanted definitely in the communities. They're needed, but I was kind of surprised and taken aback by the murmur that went through the crowd when Michael spoke about the preacher who had buried 186 people. I was surprised by that reaction because, what do you think is the result of the type of capitalism we practice? I'm not an anti-capitalist at all, but what we do here is create communities and situations like this so we can accumulate obscene, not just wealth, not a great deal, but obscene amount of wealth in a small section of not even society, just a small section. So these are all byproducts. These are all logical byproducts of the lives we've led, the people we're trying to help, the communities we're trying to rebuild. They're byproduct of the lives we lead as a country. So I'm not so surprised. We have to take a real honest look at what we do as a country.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Sonia, that's actually a great intro to you to talk about what you've put together, Wired for Change. Talk about that.
Rewired for Change.
Rewired.
I knew it was coming.
All I could think was Wired. Rewired for Change.
Well, Rewired for Change was an idea that I came up with in the fall of 2008 when the Wirecast was asked to do some voter empowerment work with Mark Morial and the National Urban League, and then we were also asked to do some campaign work on behalf of now President Obama in North Carolina. And one of the things that we saw that really blew our minds was how much cultural capital we had in these communities from which all of us, come.
From the show.
Yeah. How we could go into a community and talk about issues or someone would actually leave a basketball game and go get into a van and go vote. How a woman, in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, in the projects, said that, everyone loves her cooking. And so if they bring a ticket, the voting ticket, back to them that proves that they had voted, then they would get a free plate from her house. And, we saw this and went, wow, like we can't just walk away. If we can, influence folks or inspire folks to, to get up and take action, in such a serious situation in terms of like a political, election, then my goodness, what else, can we help inspire folks, excuse me, to do? And so, I talked to the boys about it, and they all love the idea, and said, listen, you put it down, we're on the team. And David said the same thing. He just said, make sure it's run professionally. And then off we went. And that's how Rewire for Change started. I think what I'm hearing here is essentially, that we have all taken actions to do what government can no longer seem to do, which is provide for not simply the less fortunate, but the masses of folks who are overlooked. If all of our nurturing programs are going to be taken away, if all of the tools for growing community are going to be taken away, if so much of the funding that is needed to bring equality to this country is going to get stuck in a ridiculous congressional fight, we the people are the ones who suffer. And so it is up to all of us, not simply just celebrities and us, but it is up to each and every one of us to provide for the people what we need. I truly, truly believe that my favorite part of the Declaration of Independence is that this is a government that is of the people, by the people, and for the people. And if the people do not take ownership of the government and do not take responsibility for what we need and what we want, and we do not make our demands known, and that we do not devise an agenda, then we will not see the change that needs to happen within the structure of the government. See, the government, you know, our entire country was founded on revolution. And revolution has been, you know, a part of our heritage here in this country. You know, social revolutions like the abolition of slavery, like the women's suffrage movement. You know, the Industrial Revolution was the basis of the comforts that we enjoyed in the 20th century. Right now, you know, we are here because of the technological revolution. We are able to, you know, have this entire conversation seen all around the world because of that. People are overthrowing governments because of the technological revolution. And this was something that was created in America. Revolution needs to not be a bad word anymore. And we need to revolutionize the system in a nonviolent way. We need to recreate something that is broken. We all need to take part in that. And so this is how we're doing it.
Yeah.
How are you going to do it?
Well, and let's just for a moment, let's talk about the role. I mean, have we given up? Are you saying you've given up on government's ability to make a difference? Is that what we're saying?
I wouldn't, you know, I just decided to take my focus off of government. I decided to take back my power. You know, I don't even get that any attention.
Yep.
I just do what I can do. You know, a friend of mine, Bobby Sager, he told me something that kind of always stuck in my head. He said, concrete baby steps. You know, if I just grab one, each one teach one, I keep it very grassroots. That government, when I start taking it into that stratosphere, I tend to get lost. I'm not that sharp. So if I keep it small and something within my grasp, I feel empowered.
Right.
I feel like I'm making a change, like I'm making progress. And it tends to work for me. You know, that tends to work.
And I believe that it's our communities, you know, that we looking at here, you know. So it's our community, it's our responsibility.
Amen.
Right.
So why are we looking at the government to do something that we should be
doing?
Exactly.
We live
right.
in this community.
Right.
Don't nobody in Washington can't tell me what we doing down here on Emerson Avenue, Poplar Grove. They don't go down there. They stay up here in Washington. So what,
right.
what we need to do is take our own steps and come together as a human society, because that's what we neglected, our humanity, you know, because we look at the people, like, for instance, three black guys walking down the street, a little white lady walking over, she's going to look at them as though they're going to rob her. They just as scared as her as she is as them. You know, because they thought, oh, man, we got to walk over here because she might start screaming and we're going to get locked up. You understand what I'm saying? We got to stop putting labels on people because of color or race or anything. We are all human.
Mm-hmm.
We got to come together. As
right.
A-
And see, Judy, these are all revolutionary ideas. You know, each one teach one, do what you can. We don't need to pick up guns and we don't need to do all of that. What we're saying is everyone here can be a visionary and everyone here can make a difference. And together we can create this internal revolution that has nothing to do with actually, you know, marching on Washington necessarily. We've got to do it at home in our communities. That's where it begins.
Because if everybody do a little, we don't have to do a lot.
We've only got a couple of minutes left, and I know the hour's getting late, but I do want to push this a little bit. Does it mean Anwan and Benga that it doesn't matter what government does? Is that what we're saying?
No, it absolutely matters, and I think a little differently about it. We get taught to that government is a separate entity, that it's wrong, it's doing this, it's not doing that.
And to a great extent it's true.
But we also, that enables us to disconnect ourselves from the responsibility of government. Government isn't that, it's mine. And if it's messing up and not feeding and being corrupted by, you know, big money and big banks, that's my fault, my responsibility. I need to take government, I need to shape it again. because this is mine. And so if we are a demobilized populace, and with a demobilized populace, it's easier for others who are of a certain stratosphere to, you know, use this populace, use this government, use this power. We just need to take it back.
Right.
Any thoughts on exactly. What matters?
What matters is this small, like Michael K. said, this small baby steps. Like in your community, your Ward 5 member, you just have to grab him and make him do what he's supposed to do. You don't have to be this big political person that's right there reading it every day if it's not your statue or what you're running with. But make that person that you voted for in your ward, in your sector, that little one small block, make him be the best Ward 5 council member.
Hold him accountable.
Hold him accountable. Or that one sector, and this is what we're doing. We molding these children right here for greatness. They're going to go off and be somebody that can come back and do what we did in the community.
Yeah, and I'm not opposed to actually shutting government down. I mean, I'm not opposed. I think you may have gathered that by now. I'm not opposed to going to the Capitol, the White House, and making sure these people can't go in or leave until, you know, their corruption is dealt with. You know, money needs to come out of government. It's ridiculous. I mean, with the Citizens United case, I've never in my lifetime
Supreme Court case.
Yes,
right.
Absolutely. That ruling. I've never seen such a politically active Supreme Court. It's disgusting.
So final thought for this audience as they leave here this evening, what should they think they can do in their own lives, in their own communities?
I think that what we need to introduce is what we need to do is introduce the idea that we came to represent here, which is the wire wake-up call.
Yeah.
You know, it is our goal to take a tour, a national tour, of a conversation, a national conversation around the country to cities and rural areas that are suffering so that you know, with the objective to provide a forum for citizens to identify issues that are important to their regions and give them an opportunity to develop solutions for those issues. What we'd like to do with this national conversation is to hold local conversation and provide these forums for overlooked populations to develop their own think tanks. See, we participated in a think tank at Harvard this spring, and we realized that you don't have to be an Ivy Leaguer to participate in a think tank. that we have brains and we have minds, and we can do our own think tanks, and that we would have these town hall days which would present opportunities for community members to explore the intricacies of the political system and the importance of their vote. Not simply that if you vote, you know, you elect someone, but, you know, how your vote is actually manipulated without you knowing it. You know, also give communities an opportunity to harness the power of their voice and their ability to enact social change. Because, see, we don't believe that we can actually make a difference. That's what's happening. This complacency that has come across the country that's most recently been, you know, we've been awakened a little bit with the Occupy Wall Street movement, you know. But we need to understand that we actually can enact social change, and we'll have conversations around that. And also understanding that you know, each region knows what it needs. That, you know, we won't be coming to a region to have a conversation to tell you what you should be doing. These will be opportunities for regions to develop ideas and solutions that are tailored to their own communities. And then also, it'll be an opportunity for community members to prioritize a list of actionable items. And then we'll be highlighting people in those areas who are doing good work, organizations who are doing good work, so that when we leave, everyone will know where to go in order to make a change and make a difference in their community. And see, that's real revolution. What are you gonna do? What's your idea? We wanna know that. Make it happen.
Anybody else just quickly on what you want these folks to take away?
Like I said earlier, you know, my new favorite word is mentorship. You know, I'm really big on grassroots. It doesn't take a lot of time or a lot of energy or a lot of money to go to your local inner city school, speak to the principal, state your name and your business, and find out who the parents are, you know. And when I say mentorship, it doesn't always have to be the kid that's so at risk. It could. I believe in what you said earlier, like reinforcement. You know, we could also get the kid that's on the fence, but that's doing good, but can use a, you know, don't worry, you're on the right track. I go keep a push him in the right direction. I'm all about the next generation. That is the future. You know, I'm really big on the next generation, and mentorship speaks to the heart of that.
And that's something that everybody can play a role in. We are being told we need to wrap it up. Everybody's got a schedule. I have to say we've gotten a lot of questions from people here and I guess on Twitter wanting to know all about what you've been talking about, as well as The Wire. A lot of questions about that. But this has been, to me, it's been a very powerful conversation. And I think everybody here has not only learned something, I think we get the depth of the passion in all of you and the commitment. And we thank you very much. Thank this amazing.